تفضل.
I'd like to thank the health outreach program today for giving us the opportunity to connect with our nursing colleagues in Gaza and Sudan to discuss issues related to chemotherapy administration and the complications that are associated with the administration of chemotherapy. This is a great opportunity for us as healthcare providers to be able to be in touch with other nurses and other parts of the world or other parts of the Arab world. This has been a really very effective session today, and we hope that we are going to conduct more sessions in the future to share expertise and to share knowledge and information aimed at improving our patient care.
البرزنتيشن اذا كان التكنيشن او المهندس موجود يسويها
نحن شوف هذا this is the full capacity للسكرين
تمام هو انا عندي تيجي عندي فور سكشن اربع مقاطع تيجي عندي اربع شاشات
شوف من عندك شوف لانه البرودكاست من عندي this is full screen for you السيجنال انا ببعثها انا full screen
لو التكنيشن بس ريموت يعدي على الوحده الفيديو كونفرنس سيستم ويخصص الاعدادات تبعت المونيتور او الستريم
طب let me call
full screen فول سكرين مش ديسكشن
خليك تكلموا خليك تكلموا انت ديو التكنيشن نفسه
هيك اوكي
اوكي اوكي هيك صار فول سكرين
اوكي
شكرا جزيلا دكتور
هلا طيب I want to carry on with our final session for today, which is the management of extravasation. I just want to put in some definitions before we get started with the management of extravasation. Extravasation, by definition, is the leakage of an agent from the vein to the surrounding tissue that causing pain, necrosis, or sloughing of tissue. Now, although this might be one of the acute complications of chemotherapy, sometimes extravasation tend to occur even at a later stage, at sometimes even for up to 48 hours or more after the administration. So once when patients report back for up to 48 hours with clinical manifestations of extravasation, we call it delayed extravasation. And this could be sometimes mainly due to circulatory issues, sometimes due to lymph node resections that could maybe alter the circulation pathways sometimes. It rarely would occur, but we'd still, even if it's not within the minute, even if it's delayed, we still call it an extravasation. Now, two things also that I want to give definition for is an irritant and a vesicant, and it's important to distinguish between both. Irritant is an agent that can cause aching, tightness, or phlebitis at the injection site or along the vein, while vesicant is an agent that is capable of causing tissue destruction. And this is the main difference between an irritant and a vesicant, is that irritant do not necessarily cause tissue destruction unless the irritant has been given in high concentration, while vesicants, even at regular concentration and even in small amounts, they are capable of tissue destruction. This is mainly due to their nature and how they will they interact with the cellular DNA because they bind to the DNA and they cause cell death, and even the components as a result of the cell death usually spread to the surrounding tissue, and that's why the tissue destruction is usually progressive when it comes to extravasation. Irritants do not have this kind of capacity. So it's very important now when we talk about extravasation is we talk about vesicant agent extravasation rather than irritants. These are the most up-to-date vesicants chemotherapeutic agents that we encounter looking at alkylating agents like nitrogen mustard. Anthracyclines, of course, are very well known for their extravasation potential and for their vesicant capability. Doxorubicin, for instance, is one of the most potent vesicants among all chemotherapeutic agents. The vinca alkaloids are also like the vinblastine, the vindicine, and the vincristine. The anti-tumor antibiotics like mitomycin and dactinomycin, of course, the dexanes like docetaxel and paclitaxel. But however, if you want to look at the most two common or the drugs with the highest risk of extravasation, we talk mainly about anthracyclines and vinca alkaloids. So it's important for anyone who is giving anyone or any of these agents just to make sure that the administration is within the guidelines, which I will be talking about in a few minutes. So what are the risk factors that are associated with extravasation? First of all, the vesicant potentiality of the drug. So when we talk, for instance, about doxorubicin versus taxanes, of course, doxorubicin has a much more vesicant potential, and therefore it constitutes a higher risk for a development of extravasation. Very young patients or elderly patients, always the extremes of age, usually have fragile skin. The elderly usually have very fragile tortuous veins, and therefore they also might be at higher risk than any other patients. Cannulas that are inserted on the side of mastectomy or where a lymph node resection have occurred or where lymphedema is present, of course, this constitutes a very high risk, and it's important that when we are inserting cannulas on the patients, just to make sure that the patient mastectomy site and whether there has been any lymph node resection on that side. Of course, patients who are unconscious or sedated or even confused, and this is simply because they cannot verbalize the clinical manifestations of extravasation. So when there is a change in the sensation during the administration, sedated, unconscious patients might be able to verbalize these symptoms, and therefore they might get unrecognized. Patients who are suffering from decreased sensation or poor circulation, especially patients with diabetes, for instance, patients with peripheral neuropathies as well, patients who have superior vena cava obstruction, and this is one of the oncologic emergencies, especially for tumors such as Hodgkin's and or lymphomas in general, lung cancer and breast cancer, where patients might develop superior vena cava obstruction. So it's very important that the any symptoms of superior vena cava obstruction are also revealed before attempting to give any vesicant agents. Patients who have had multiple vein puncture or cannula sites causing thrombosed vessels, and this would lead to the vessels being more compromised to be exploded with when you administer the chemotherapy, especially the IV push. Needle insertion technique, especially when you are inserting the cannula, you need to make sure that usually you don't make lots of attempts at the same site. Like for instance, if you put in the cannula and you had to go left and right and up and down to really get the cannula in, this is a very poor technique, and that would not constitute a good site for administration of vesicant agents. Old peripheral IV sites of more than 24 hours. Patients' anatomy, especially patients who have deformities, Patients, for instance, who have diabetes, who are obese, or patients who have actually have any problems with their vein anatomy. The amount of vesicant infiltrated, of course, the more the amount infiltrated, the higher is, or the more is the tissue damage. And this is here is important to adhere to the strict guidelines of administration is when you give 1 to 2 cc's per minute, and when you check for blood return every 2 to 3 cc's, just to make sure that if extravasation would actually occur, that you have not given so much and tissue damage would be minimal. The duration of exposure here as well, if the patient have had extravasation, for instance, and the procedure for the management was delayed, that would constitute to a more tissue destruction. Vein puncture size as well, if you are giving this over a bony prominent area or over a joint, this might cause also more damage to the area. But most importantly, if you are putting a cannula near the joint, then this cannula might not be as fixed as you would imagine, and therefore there's a great chance that this cannula might be dislocated from its position. We rely a lot on the clinical manifestations of patients who are receiving vesicant agents, and therefore patient teaching is very important before the administration of chemotherapy, assessment of the site before the administration as well, making sure that the patient is aware of what you will be doing, and patient is aware what kind of symptoms that they should be reporting to you. So any change in sensation, such as pain, burning and coldness, swelling at the site, redness at the site, sluggish or no blood return, and this is important here, to check the blood return every 2 to 3 cc's, and to check also the flow of the IV fluids, because when the quality of the IV fluids flow has changed, or the blood return quality has changed, that puts lots of question marks on the integrity of the vein and whether you can continue with the administration of drugs like doxorubicin, for instance, and risk having an extravasation. So now that we've looked at the risk factors, there is a way actually that you could minimize the risk of extravasation. Extravasation is a high risk, but at our institution here, it's a very low volume. And the reason for that is that because we have strict guidelines, we have strict policies and procedure with regard to the administration of chemo and with regard to the guidelines for the prevention of extravasation. We focus a lot even in our programs, in our teaching programs. As I mentioned, this course, we actually give it over 2 days, and now we are trying to give it in 3 hours. We focus a lot on how do you prevent the extravasation, because it's important, I think, to prevent rather than having to deal with the consequences. So with the vein selection, you always want to start distal, and you want to go up, you want to go proximal. The reason is if you start proximal or if you start up, although there might be maybe a good veins up, and you might be tempted to try with the big veins, but once you put in the cannula in the upper veins, then if the cannula did not go in, then you cannot be using the distal veins as well. So therefore, we always need to make sure that we are starting from the lowest point and we go up. It's good to choose large diameter veins, especially when you are giving drugs, for instance, like doxorubicin, or you're giving large doses with like epirubicin, for instance, and you're giving other protocols like with ABVDs, or you're giving hydration with it. You want to make sure that the integrity of the vein is going to remain intact even with large amounts of chemo and even with lots of stress on the vein as well. So we tend to choose a larger diameter veins than rather than smaller veins. The clean, smooth cannula insertion, this is the what I talked about, is moving left and right during the insertion. The insertion of the cannula should be one smooth insertion. You should not be going and trying to fish for the blood return just to get it in. So it has to be a clean, smooth cannula insertion. The mid-forearm versus sides over nerves, tendons, or joints. And again, you want to avoid these sites simply because some of them, because they are not very well, you cannot fix the cannula very well, or you have to take into consideration if extravasation happens, you wouldn't want to cause damage to the tendon or to the nerve or even to a joint and cause permanent deformity. One of the other things is inserting the cannula on the opposite arm from the lab draw. As you know, most of our patients, they get labs drawn before the chemo, sometimes one day before, sometimes in the morning. You want to make sure that the cannula is inserted on the opposite side of the lab draw. And it's important thing to consider, especially if the person who drew the lab is different from the person administering the chemo. It's just to make sure that there's a coordinated effort between both. Opposite of the mastectomy site and opposite also of any lymph node resection site. Securing the IV so that the catheter site is always visible. So dressings over the IV site should be transparent dressing. You should not be attempting to cover the site with a gauze or with anything that is going to obscure your vision of the site. Because it's very important to notice if there are redness or swelling, it's very important that you are able to notice those changes along the site. Vesicants always should be administered through a free-flowing IV, unless you are giving them through a central line and using a pump. If you are not giving them through a central line and you are using peripheral, then you need to make sure that there's always a free-flowing IV because you always want to be flushing those vesicant agents. You also want to monitor the blood return, as Julie has mentioned, in 2 to 3 cc's, asking the patients to report the change in sensation, and you always want to listen to the patient. Any complaints from the patients about pain or burning should not be ignored, should be investigated. Might not always be a sign of extravasation, but always want to listen to the patient. Even when the patient is very much of a complainer and he always complains, and as we say, ما بيعجب العجب. So you always want to make sure that you always listen even to these patients. You always also want to flush with saline first and between drugs. You should never attempt to start your administration with chemotherapy first. Make sure that you pass some normal saline, either through the bag or with a syringe if you want to, but you always want to make sure that you have saline first and between drugs. This is when you have more than one drug to push. Checking for the signs of the extravasation, and again, any signs of no blood return or the IV rate becomes sluggish or the quality changes. Know the extravasation policy. And here, if you want to go back to the duration of extravasation, if you are aware of what the extravasation policy is, then you are more able to intervene quickly. If you do not know what the extravasation policy is, then the problem is that this is going to delay the interventions, and this is going to cause more damage to the tissues. You do not want also to allow patients who are infusing chemotherapy, even if it's piggyback, to progress off your site or off the ward area. If a vesicant drug is to be given as a continuous IV, it must be administered through a central line. You cannot give continuous vesicant IV through a peripheral line. This presents a very high risk, and it's a big no in any reference that you could go to. Continuous IV infusions on a vesicants should be always given through a central line. Now, I want to spend some time now talking about the, actually demonstrating some of the nursing management. So I'm just going to take you back to the camera. You can see me well now? Okay, so I just want to take you back here. I'm going to try also to demonstrate some of the steps that we want to do in the management. Okay, so I just put this in here. It's just to make you remember that you are giving the chemo, so you are obviously wearing your gown, wearing your gloves, and any other protective equipment that you should be holding, right? So if you just allow me, I'm going to pretend that I have this equipment on, and I just want to show you how do we manage the extravasation. So suppose that you are giving the chemo, as Julie has mentioned, IV push through the hub here, and the patient started to complain of symptoms of extravasation. So the patient tells you, for instance, I have pain, there's a burning sensation, and I look at the blood return, I check the blood return, there's no blood return, I check at the quality of the IV, the quality is sluggish now, so I conclude now that I might have extravasation and I need to do my interventions here. So the first thing I want to do is actually I want to stop the administration of chemo. And I want to disconnect my syringe, and I want to put a clean hub on it, and I want to leave it for later. Of course, you don't want to discard the chemo, it's expensive. Keep it sterile and save it, and you can give it later. The second step that I want to do here is, of course, you need to stop the IV flow rate. You want to put a small 2x2 gauze just between the cannula and the IV here. I'm sure you could all see this. So this is okay? All right, so here, what I want to do, some organizations, they have an extravasation kit, but if you don't have one, this is still okay. What you could do actually is you make sure that you have 1cc syringes. Those are the same ones that you use for insulin, right? You need to have also some hubs or some, what we use here, we use something called a clave. I'm not sure if you all have this kind, but anything that can close, you can close the cannula with, should be okay. Okay? So what I want to do, I've closed my IV, I want to disconnect from the cannula, and I want to close this because I want to make sure that I'm not going to have any spillage later on. So I'm going to hang this in a safe place, and I want to connect my 1cc syringe directly to the cannula. I want to attempt to aspirate. The reason why I need a small syringe compared to a large syringe, if you use a large syringe, you might actually cause lots of suction power, and therefore you might cause actually more damage, and you might not be able to get any feedback through the syringe. All right? So you want to use 1cc syringe, and you want to attempt to aspirate any residual drug from here from the cannula. Even if you get some blood, that's still okay. So I want to attempt to aspirate about 3 to 5 cc's, and I'm going to use multiple syringes to do that. So just get about 3 to 5 syringes of these and attempt to aspirate 3 to 5 cc's. When you finish aspirating, make sure that you close the cannula. I do not want to remove the cannula just yet because I need to make sure that the physician is going to be contacted. And if there is an antidote to be given, sometimes the best place to give the antidote is actually directly through the cannula. Sometimes it might be given around the cannula, around the tissue, but most of the time you can give it through the cannula. So I want to keep the cannula, not to give any chemo in it, but just to keep it for the antidote. Okay? So I've closed the cannula, I can remove the dirty gauze, dispose it properly, and here I want to elevate the arm. Elevating the arm is just to decrease the edema and to decrease any discomfort on the patient. Using also warm versus cold compressors. Now, there is a rule for the use of cold versus warm. The cold compressors are used for the warm compressors are used for vinca alkaloids only. Those are the vincristine, the vindicine, and the vinblastine. I don't want to use the word hot because you don't want to burn the patient. It should be warm. A towel, just warm it with hot water or with warm water, should do okay. So I want to put it on the side, I want to elevate it, and I want to keep it for 20 minutes, okay? And I want to repeat that about 4 to 6 times a day for 24 to 48 hours. Now, all other vesicants, aside from the vinca alkaloids, you can use the cold compress. And it's the same principle, just cold water or iced water, put it in there for 20 minutes, 4 to 6 times a day. Okay? Now, here, of course, reassuring the patient, because you were giving chemo, you suddenly stopped. Patients might have lots of questions, so you need to make sure that you also address this. You want to address their concerns, and you want to make sure that you tell them the truth. All right? Tell them what to expect from the extravasation as well. Here, at this point, if you haven't called in the physician, this is the right time to call the physician. If there is an antidote to be given, then you give it through the cannula. If no antidote to be given, then you just remove the cannula. There's no need for the cannula to be kept at the site. Okay? Now, once we have reassured the patient, we have contacted the physician, now it's actually time to... if we go back here.
So, I have a question, please.
That's right. Go ahead.
How long shall we wait before giving the antidote?
There's no waiting time to give the antidote. It's important.
Cold pressing or warm pressing according to the type of chemotherapy. And what about antidote? What should limit first?
The antidote can be given immediately once available. When you're talking about antidote, definitely you're not talking about many hours. You are talking about minutes.
Okay.
But that should not stop you. Should not stop you from the using the compressors. Okay.
Okay.
Other question, please.
Go ahead.
According to the definition of delayed extravasation,
yes.
I think the nurses are not more often blamed for the results, yes? It's
okay. Actually, 48. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, no. Sometimes it happens even though you have done everything according to the book and you have done everything that you can to minimize it, it still could occur. And this is, here is nobody's fault to blame. When that happens, but again, how do we know that the nurse or the person who is giving the chemo has done everything that they can to prevent the extravasation? How do you know that? I'm asking this question for everyone.
No complaint of from the patient. If no is, complaint of from.
What if it was a very nice patient who doesn't want to cause any problem for the nurse? It's important that the nurse documents exactly what she has done with or without an extravasation. So when you are giving chemotherapy, it's important that you document how you have given the chemotherapy, what strategies did you follow to give the chemotherapy, the cannula insertion, the gauge of the cannula site, the technique of administration. This should be documented in the patient's chart. Now, when extravasation happens, we can go back to the chart and we can look, okay, how did the nurse administer this chemotherapy? Was there any risk? Did she attempt like 2 to 3 times to put in the cannula? Was the cannula inserted on the same site of mastectomy site? So there's a lots of things that needs to be looked at from this perspective. But you are right. Sometimes you do everything by the book and extravasation could still happen. However, I would like to highlight that extravasation is a preventable. In 99% of the cases, it's preventable, and there's actually something that you could do about it. We are here at the hospital. We are really very proud. I've been working here for almost 13 years, going into my 14th year here, and I haven't seen actually a very serious extravasation happening at the organization simply due to the standards that has been put in place in the organization. All right. So I just want to go back to the slides. I've discussed all of this, so I just want to go quickly over it. So it's warm or heat for all vinca alkaloids, and these are the four drugs that you apply warm compressors, and you use cold for all other vesicants, regardless of their nature.
I think there are other drugs needed to warm compressors, otherwise vinca alkaloids, like oxaloplatin.
Yeah.
Paclitaxel also need the hot compresses. Oxaloplatin, paclitaxel, vinca alkaloids all need hot compresses.
Okay, you might be right in this. Those are the ones that I think that are the most common that we look at with the oxaliplatin and the they are not on the vesicants list of drugs, but therefore there are many irritant drugs out there that you would also use warm compressor. You are right. As with the nursing management, again, we've talked about this already. Arranging for photography here is simply to look at any future or future visits with the patient, just to see the progress of the extravasation. And as I mentioned with the compressors, 20 minutes, QIDs for 24 hours, or as ordered. Documentation should be thorough documentation. Everything should be included. I will be sending this presentation to Mr. Asad, so you'll have access to all the information on the presentation. So no need to worry about the information here. So again, this is more detailed documentation of the things that should be included in the patient's chart. And believe me, when extravasation happens, this is very serious. Sometimes it can cause permanent deformity. It can cause interfere with the function of the extremity of the patient. So you want to make sure that you are within the legal parameters, that you are covered with your documentation. This is just, I just want to go ahead and show you some pictures on the sequel of vesicant extravasation. Mainly permanent joint stiffness is one of the complications, loss of the function, infection, cellulitis, delay in recovery, longer stay in the hospital, and of course this is an increased cost, whether the cost is covered by the patient or covered by the organization. Here, I just want to show you, I'm not sure how, is this picture clear for you?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so you could see here the blisters. Yes. You can see the blisters. Yes. Okay, so this is the first stage with the erythema and blistering. This is an extravasation with doxorubicin. You could see here the beginning of tissue necrosis and the sloughing of tissue here. You could see the black margins at the site. There's a lot of necrosis going on here, and it's really obvious. This is here after debridement, and the tissue is just beginning to heal. And this is how the healed tissue will look like, and you could see how much is this has caused on the patients with regard to defects. So the complications of extravasations are pretty serious, and they might have lots of changes on the patient's quality of life afterwards. And that's why we consider it one of the high risks, and we really focus a lot on dealing with the prevention rather than dealing with the actual extravasation. This is just my email again, just in case. And again, Mr. Asad should have access to my email. If you are not able to get my email, definitely you can communicate with us, and you can have the freedom, Mr. Asad. Perhaps if anyone asks, you can feel free to give them my email access as well. We are done for our session today. So do you have any questions before we close? Sudan, do you have any questions?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay. Just I am confused in this point about nursing role, about this chemotherapy. What? Are you hear me?
I didn't understand your question.
Okay. Just I'm confused about this nursing role. Okay?
What is confusing you?
Okay. In oncology unit, how I because I contact with this medical waste in fluids, on these containers, on solutions, how can I manage this waste? And what is my role as a nurse in this unit? For waste, you know what?
You mean what's your role with regard to chemotherapy process, administration?
Yes, I'm confused for this issue.
I'm not sure if I'm following the questions very well. The confusion is about the nurse's role in the administration.
Yes, not in administration. This lesson is discussed by the Mr. Hassan in Paris lecture.
Safe but, handling?
Yes.
Do you mean the preparation versus administration?
No. How can I manage this work?
Okay, if your question is with regard to confusion on whose role to prepare the chemotherapy, and I can tell you the role is in our institution is for pharmacists. Pharmacists are the only allowed people to prepare chemotherapy, and even if they need to prepare chemo, it should be their special hoods or biologic safety cabinets that are needed to be in place to prepare the chemo. Nurses should not be preparing chemotherapy at the unit at all. This is very dangerous. It causes lots of health risks on the person preparing and on other healthcare providers and the environment where the chemotherapy is being prepared.
No. My question, okay? How can I manage this waste after I give or administrate this chemo for the our patients? How can I manage this waste in my situation on oncology unit as a nurse? Okay. Yeah, not as a management, okay?
How you can manage?
Implementation?
You mean how you can implement this?
Yes.
Okay, what about if we can give her the guidelines?
The policies and procedure. I can email you the policy and procedure for our organization. You could have a look at it and see. I mean, every institution is different because of the resources available. But we could give you our guidelines and you could
discuss it with your email. I contact you in your email and discuss this one.
Sure.
Inshallah.
Thank you for you.
Okay. Any other question?
In our names in Gaza, we want to thank you.
Father.
Hussein Washed from
Gaza.
We still have a question, please. We have said that chemotherapy is teratogenic and the safety handling is very important while preparing the chemotherapy. What about pregnant pharmacists or breastfeeding pharmacists? Is it safe enough for her to join the chemo preparing the chemotherapy?
We have a very very strict policy. If you are pregnant or breastfeeding, you can refrain from giving chemotherapy or coming in contact with patients on precautions. So our policy is that the nurses can request to transfer or can request an assignment that does not include administration of chemo or handling patients' body fluids. Okay.
Hello. Your efforts are very appreciated here in Gaza, also in, of course in Sudan. We hope in the near future we can expect more lectures about the oncology patient, especially side effects of chemotherapy, like leukopenic patient, how to deal with them, side effects, nausea, vomiting, pain management.
I would, and we would really appreciate this kind of feedback. We always want to present something, and we were just talking about this with Mr. Asad. We wanted to deliver things that are actually that you need. I think I'm not sure what the process is.
Just feel free to send your suggestions to Dr. Muna at CCCME. Today I will send you, inshallah, the address of Dr. Muna, and also I will send you the presentations and the email of Mr. Hassan, inshallah. And the door is open for you to suggest. If you want to, for example, to meet with you live with the concert department, with Dr. Mahmoud and the others, we are ready to do so.
We are happy also to meet over Skype or, technology now has allowed us to become much closer no matter where we are. Yeah.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Okay,
thank
I would
you.
Like to, thank you. I would like to thank you for participating today in Sudan and in Gaza, and I really want to take this chance لوجه تحياتي لأهل غزة فعلاً يعني برغم كل اللي صار عليكم. You are here today and watching us and learning and getting information. I really want to فعلا نحييكم لكل هالأمور هاي.
شكرا
Thank you.
إذا أحد يحب يأخذ شهادة للحضور هذه احنا ممكن نرسلها لكم إن شاء الله لكم بإذن الله.
وأكيد إحنا الكل
عايز
ياخذ الشهادة يعني
طيب ممتاز. Just in Gaza you can give your name to Dr. Khamis or we can arrange who is the coordinator and also for Sudan the same thing. To make it easier for us, try to put the rank in one field and the complete name in one field in Excel and Word as a table so that we can convert it and it will be very easy for us. And we do not make any mistakes in your spelling name. Okay?
Thank you.